few days back, I have given an assignment we discussed a string comparison, right? Double equals and equals method using.
Yes.
Yes.
And I asked you to work out with a string buffer. And I
Yes.
asked you
Yes.
to find out the results.
Yes.
Yes.
Can you tell me what happens with a string buffer using double equals comparison as well as equals method?
Yes.
Did you work out on that?
Excuse
Yes.
me?
Yes.
Yeah, we got the answers.
The answer.
What's the result?
Yeah, for the string buffer
Huh.
using the equals method, when you compare the two strings using those equals, it doesn't work. I mean, when you have, for example, hello for the
Huh.
first string and for the second string also you have hello and you try to
Huh.
use dot equals method to compare them, the result is false because the string buffer it doesn't override the string method by default.
Right. Absolutely. Right.
Yes.
Good.
And for the equals, double equals, it works the same as the way
Right.
the string works, as in to compare the two remote control in like a pool
Right.
when they
Right.
are on different memory location. So the answer is false.
Fine.
Yes.
That is, it's not similar to string, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
With string, it behaves peculiarly because the equals method in a string is overridden.
Yeah.
Yes.
By default, the equals method that is present in the java.lang.object, that is equals method, always checks for the remote controls. That is the default
Yes.
implementation.
Yes.
Right. So today we look into an example string tokenizer.
Okay.
Yeah.
So string tokenizer. So I'm creating a string tokenizer. So you can see string tokenizer. Which it takes a string as an argument. So I give a message. So
Message.
what the string tokenizer is. The string tokenizer is a class which is used to identify the tokens that are present in a string. So what these tokens are. For example, I have a message like this is a string tokenizer demo. It is used to split the string into pieces, comma, which are separated by a symbol. Symbol, comma. These tokens are, or these pieces are known as tokens. So this is my message, semicolon at the end. You can see here, I have a message. Let me cut down this message. Maximize. Yes. This is my complete message. So this is a string. Completely, this is a string. In this string, there are pieces of strings that are comma separated, right? Comma separated.
Yes.
So here, this piece in the complete message can be read as one token.
Okay.
This piece, second token, then comma separated. This piece, third token. This piece, fourth token.
Token.
How many tokens are there?
Four.
And how many separators are there, commas?
Three.
Right. Do you remember that? So three, I mean to say, n separators would result n plus one tokens, right?
Right.
Now, so I'm going to get each piece as a token and display them.
Okay.
So I'm using for display from the given message. I use a while loop. So while this string token is there, dot. I can see here. So has more
tokens.
Mm-hmm. Has more tokens. It is returning a boolean value.
Mm-hmm.
So if there are more tokens, then str tokens dot next token. I can see over there, next token.
Mm-hmm.
Semicolon. So this will give the next token. I mean to say one token. That is nothing but a string. String token.
Okay.
And I am going to display them. So token. And here, while defining the string tokenizer, this is the message, and I have to give what is the delimiter over there. That is comma. So there is a constructor in string tokenizer which will take two arguments. The first is the string, and the second one is the separator.
All right.
Now let me execute this. So can you see here? First token, then second token is, there is a space and then a message. I mean this one. This one. It begins with space. Can you observe?
Yeah.
That's what. Let me show console. So likewise, it is displaying all the tokens over there. So here, with the help of while loop, we can navigate across that complete string message and get each token. So get each piece that is separated by comma. Got it?
Yes.
So here, if you don't give the separator, this separator, you make use of the string tokenizer with one argument, that is message. There is no separator. Then by default, space is considered as a token.
Space.
Yes, not space.
Okay.
So I'm just making a note here. By default, space is considered as a token. Right. So that's about string tokenizer. This is also one of the important things under core Java. So suppose some companies are conducting a written test in Java Azure, or there, if they ask you to write some programs, they will there may be programs using string tokenizer. So the string tokenizer generally is used to navigate across the given string and bring each token. So
right.
Like for example, there may be such question like they will give you a string IP address. Maybe the IP addresses would be like 102.102.205.166.255. So the IP address would be like this, right?
All right.
Yeah.
So they will ask you to display each piece in that IP address, which are separated by dot order.
Yes. Yes.
So you can use string tokenizer in splitting that.
Okay.
So you make a try with this example.
Oh.
So I'm asking you to split this IP address into pieces and display that each piece. Got it?
Okay.
Got it.
Then we will look into threats concept. So threats being the last part, before threats, let us finish access specifiers. I believe you are familiar with access specifiers, so I'm just writing down here access specifiers. So access specifiers, name the access specifiers according to the restriction level, right from no restriction to little restriction, then little more restriction, then highly restricted, like this.
Public.
Public. Good. Next.
Protected.
Protected. Right.
Private is the last one. Private.
Is last. Yes. Private is last one. Yes. Before that.
There is what is it?
So what is the last one you are missing out?
can you remind me?
I am giving a clue. It is a friendly access specifier.
It is?
Friendly.
It's a clue. I was talking about. Okay.
I want the actual one. Friendly access specifier is the clue.
I can't hear you well.
Friendly access specifier is the clue I am giving you to find out the last one which you are missing out.
It is what else? The default, right?
Right.
Yeah. I couldn't forget it.
Do you have default keyword to specify that access specifier?
No.
No.
We just leave it like
right.
that.
Right. We don't have any qualifier with the variable or class, then we say that it has friendly access specifier or default access specifier. Right?
Yes. Right.
Right. Absolutely. So when you define something, so these access specifiers can be used with class and members in a class.
Yes.
So members in the sense may be variable, method, right?
Yes.
Member variable. Now, if a member has a public access specifiers, it means it can be accessed in the sense used anywhere in the project, right?
Yes.
Right.
The project may be having four packages, assume.
Yeah.
Each package representing a module, right, generally.
Yeah.
So you can access it from any class in the project, from any package, right?
Right.
And if it is protected, so what happens here? It is little restricted compared to public. So the member that is marked as protected is accessed in
the
current class, then inherited class, inherited class in the same package,
yeah,
and other classes in the pack in the same package,
yeah,
and finally inherited classes from different packages. Got it?
Got it.
Yeah. Right. Only inherited classes. From different packages. In the current package, of course, it is completely available throughout the package, right?
Right.
Right.
With the default, so it is accessed in current class, inherited classes, and other classes in the package also.
Mm-hmm.
All these things, but not in other packages.
Okay.
So we call it as package level access specifier also.
Yes.
Right. Good. Then private. Of course, it is restricted to only that class.
Yes.
So private is the one which is highly restricted.
Mm-hmm.
So we have mentioned the access specifiers in an order here. No restriction, little more restriction, highly restricted.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. So if you go right from down to up, highly restricted. So here the restriction is cut down to some extent. Restriction is cut down to some more extent. Here, no restriction. Right?
Yeah. Right.
Right.
Yes, that's about the access specifiers. And the last topic in our revision under Core Java is, threads. So threads, can you define a thread?
I think it can be defined as a piece or a part of a code of the project.
Right. Piece of code, better say piece of code in a program, not the entire project.
So
if you consider project over there, project is a combination of multiple programs.
Yes.
So piece of code in a program can be considered as a thread. So program can be considered as process or job. Right?
Yes.
The whole task, right?
Task.
So here, if you get into the technical definition, thread is a part of the process which has its own execution path. So this makes the difference actually, which has its own execution path. For example, I'm talking about an environment that is known as single tasking environment. So where there is a CPU, Yes, this is the CPU version, and to this CPU we are giving some processes. So P1 is nothing but downloading a file. Okay. Then, so how do we do this? So it is given like this. Right. So P1 is a process given to CPU, and the CPU works out on that P1 process and downloads the file. Assume I am giving another process here, and this downloading file, assume it takes 1 minute. Okay. Means CPU has to work out on this for 1 minute continuously, so that this P1 process would be completed, right?
Right.
So assume I am giving another process, P2. So P2, which is listening to a music file, which goes for 3/4 minute, assume.
Right.
So here it is a single tasking environment, I told you. It means CPU can execute only one task at a time. Single tasking environment means. So CPU will work out on this P1 process that is given to CPU for continuously 1 minute. I mean, because it is 1 minute. And finishes that. Next, in the same path, you can see the same path here. Same path. P2 is given to CPU. Now CPU continuously work for 3/4 minutes and plays that music file, right?
Right.
So I say play the music file. of course, we are listening the file. For CPU, it is playing the file, right?
Right.
So P3, I am giving another, and so let me put this in place. Before. P3, I am giving, and P3 is executing a program. So you have written a Java program and you are executing that.
Mm-hmm.
And this is taking half minute, assume. So I have written a big program where CPU has to spend half minute to finish that. And I am giving another P4 process. Which is formatting a Word document. So which takes 1 minute. Okay. So the thing to be observed is these processes are given to CPU and CPU is going to execute one by one and it is spending 1 minute continuously on P1. It finishes. Only then it takes the P2 process, which is coming in the same path. You can see the same path, right?
Mm, right.
So like this, in single tasking environment, CPU can spend on only single task. It finishes the task, then it goes for second task.
Yes.
Then it goes for third, fourth, like this, which are coming in the path. There is one path here. All the processes are traveling in that path, moving in that path towards CPU.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Yes.
Yeah.
Now I am talking about multitasking environment. So multitasking environment. So in multitasking environment, our operating system, so which you are using, maybe Windows 8 or Windows 7, is a multitasking operating system, right?
Yes.
Right.
You can perform all these four tasks simultaneously, right?
Yes.
Right. So it looks like all the tasks are being executed by CPU concurrently, right?
Right.
So, what happens, how it is handling this type of multiple task execution means, so here there is CPU, so to this CPU we are giving the processes, so maybe P1, P2, right? P2, then P3, P4, right. So here, this complete task, I mean to say processes are considered to be represented in a job queue. So this is a job queue. So the job queue. So here, whatever the process is present in the queue, assume this is the first one. This is given to the CPU. And the P4, how much time it is consuming? In our example,
one minute.
So here, CPU has some time to work out on the process. So that time is known as quantum, we call it as. So what time it is means, for example, consider CPU can spend 1 minute for processing. And we have how many processors? 4 processors, right, currently running.
Yes,
so 1 minute by 4 processors, how many seconds? 15 seconds, right? So this 15 seconds known as quantum. 15 seconds is known as quantum. So here, CPU can spend 15 seconds on each process.
Mm-hmm.
So P4 process is given to CPU and CPU executes for 15 seconds. So after executing P4 process for 15 seconds, does the P4 process get finished completely?
No.
No. So it gets executed only partially, right?
Yes.
So partially executed. So this partially executed process P4 would be producing some partial results also, right?
Yeah.
Partial results.
Yes.
So these partial results are stored in a context switch. So an area known as context switch. Okay?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay.
And then this P4, after getting CPU time, it travels again back and it gets into the
P1.
I mean, it gets into the same job queue.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So let me remove this P4. Got it?
Got
it. Following the job queue again. It is entering the job queue again.
Mm-hmm.
And now P3 gets CPU time, right?
Yeah.
Right.
So here let me write the time duration. Time duration left after processing. After processing. So this is time duration for P1, P2, P3, P4. These are the processes. Now, in round one, in first round. So P1, let me give, P4 we have done, right? P4.
Yeah.
So P4, let me explain and then I'll put this, I'll fill this. So now P3 gets time. CPU can spend only 15 seconds.
Yeah.
And the P3 needs how much time? 30 seconds, sir. So CPU spends only 15 seconds and it produces a partial results for P3. And those are stored in context switch. Then P3 again goes back and follows the job queue.
Mm-hmm.
It joins it. This here. Right?
Right.
Now P2 gets the chance. So P2 needs 3/4 minute, 45 seconds there. And CPU can spend 15 seconds and it produces partial results. Again, this P2 follows this queue, right?
Right.
So P2 comes here. Then P1 gets the chance. So P1, how much time does it take? 1 minute again.
Yeah.
And CPU spent only 15 seconds and produces partial results for this. And P1 then joins this job queue. Okay?
Okay.
Okay.
Now again P4 got the second chance, right?
Right.
Yes.
That is in second round it is. Second round. So with the first round, P1, how much time left after processing for P1? P1 takes 1 minute and it requires 45 seconds more, right?
Yeah.
P2?
45.
Which requires 3/4 minute and requires another 30 seconds, right?
Yes.
Yes.
T3, which is half minute, right? Which requires further 15 seconds, right?
Yes.
T4, which requires another 45 seconds, right?
45,
so
it yes.
is 1 minute.
Mm.
Now with the second round, P1 would require another 30 seconds, right?
Right.
Right.
15. P2 would require another 15.
Yeah.
And P3, 0. It means
done.
It gets finished, right? Finished.
Yeah.
T4, 30.
That's 30.
Now, in our job queue, there are only 3 jobs.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So now, third round, it goes. Third round. So it requires 15 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
And this gets finished.
Yes, yeah. Finish.
And this, of course, we don't have. And this needs mm-hmm. another 15 seconds.
15,
okay.
Yeah.
And round 4. So this gets finished. This gets
finished.
So whatever finished. The job gets finished, it will be removed from the job queue.
Yes.
So in 4 rounds, all the tasks get finished. So the thing here to be noticed is, each task is getting only some time with the CPU. And CPU is switching to another task after processing the task that is given to CPU. So here there is a context switch among the processes. This switching context is performed in very, very, very minute seconds, very short duration. Here I have given an example as a 15 seconds, but it happens in microseconds, nanoseconds also, because today's processors, we have i5, i7 processor, right?
Yeah.
Right.
So which performs millions of instructions per second.
Yes.
So the context switch is very, very, very high, where we humans are unable to notice that context switch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It looks like CPU is performing multiple tasks concurrently, but actually,
yeah, at the same time, yeah.
At one particular point, only one process is being executed.
Yes.
So the faster rate of execution will give a kind of environment where the processes are executing simultaneously. So this is what happens in multitasking environment. So this type of scheduling the tasks, scheduling the processes to CPU is known as round robin scheduling.
Round robin. Okay.
So this is an algorithm actually.
Mm,
algorithm
yeah.
followed by operating system to execute the tasks that are given to CPU.
Yes.
There may be n number of other algorithms which the operating system may be following. I just highlighted one particular algorithm, round robin scheduling. So that's about multitasking environment. Sometimes in these job queues, there may be tasks or processes that would have priorities.
Yes.
So priority. So based upon the priority, the process would be given to CPU.
Okay.
So assume P1 has a priority of 10. Assume P2 has a priority of 5. P3 has a priority of 2. P4 has a priority of 1. Okay, these are the priorities assigned. In Java, these priorities would range between 1 and 10. 1 being the minimum priority.
Okay.
And 10 being the max priority. It means high priority.
Yeah.
And there is normal priority, that is 5. Okay?
Okay.
So now, can you please tell me which process would be given to CPU based upon the priority? P4, P1, P2, P3, which one?
The first.
P1, first.
First one, it means P1, right?
Yes.
Yes, and P2.
Then next. Next. Next, P2. Next.
P3.
Then P4.
Next P4, right. And based upon P4, the priority. Yeah. So,
yes.
There are scheduling algorithms that would work on priority scheduling. So, priority scheduling. Now, I am getting into the threads. So, threads, as I told you, they are part of process. So, threads are always associated a process.
Mm-hmm.
So one process can be divided into multiple threads.
Yes.
So for example, there is a process P1 which would be given to CPU. So which moves in one path. When this process, maybe this process has divided into, assume threads P1. Threads T2, threads T3, assume.
T3.
So now these threads are given to the CPU in their own paths. I mean, this T1 will be having, so I say now we have these three threads that are associated with this process. So T1 would be having its own path. So assume. So we have a CPU here. So this is the CPU, and you can see here T1 is coming in this path. So T2 is coming in this path. Do you observe? T2 is coming in its own path.
Mm-hmm.
T3 in its own path.
Yes.
In its own path. Now CPU, so here as these threads are coming in their own path, this CPU would execute them simultaneously. You can assume this CPU previously with this thing. CPU has one hand to process this. So we work with our hands. So I'm just simulating the work done by the CPU with our hands with the human being. With a single hand, how much quantity of work can you do? And if you compare that work with doing multiple hands, I mean to say two hands. So with two hands, can you do or can you finish the work soon? Or with a single hand, can you finish the work soon? Assume there are peanuts in a plate.
Mm-hmm.
And I ask you to take these peanuts one by one from one plate and put in second plate.
Mm-hmm.
If I allow you to do it with a single hand, assume it is taking 1 minute. If I allow you to do with two hands, can you do it soon or will it take some more time, more than 1 minute?
I can do it soon.
Soon. Likewise, you can consider these threads as multiple hands. And CPU is working out with multiple hands.
Okay.
Oh.
So that is why these things would get finished soon.
Yes.
Okay.
They are coming in their own paths. That is the reason.
Okay.
And threads are lightweight processors. So what these lightweight processes are? So lightweight processors means they consume less computer resources. So less computer resources. What are the computer resources? For example, the memory, CPU time. So these are very expensive. So threads would consume less computer resources for execution. So this is also another advantage. So lightweight components we say. So lightweight component better say. Because threads are part of the process. I cannot say threads are lightweight processes. Instead, I can say threads are lightweight components.
Yeah.
Right. So, how do we write these threads in Java? So we have a separate API for writing these threads in Java. So we have thread class, right? Thread class, which is present in the package. Can you name the package?
No idea.
Java.lang package.
Oh, okay.
You remember the package. Okay.
Okay.
Mm. And we have in the thread API, we have runnable interface, right? Have you heard of this runnable interface?
Yes.
Yes. Threads can be created either by extending this thread class or by implementing this runnable interface, right?
Yes. Yeah, right.
Right. So two ways. So in thread class, can you define some methods present in it?
No, I don't.
I'll list out. So there are methods like current thread. What is the current thread running? Likewise. Set priority. You can set priority.
Mm-hmm.
Get priority.
Okay.
Sleep method. Write.
Okay.
Run method. Write. Start method. Write.
Yeah.
Stop method. Write.
Okay.
So. Whereas with the runnable interface, there is only one method that is run, right?
Okay.
So the thing is, of course, there are many more methods also in thread. If you observe over there, the thread class is having the properties that are talking about thread features. So threads priority, threads sleep behavior, threads run execution, thread is getting started, thread is stopping. Do you understand?
Yes.
So
can you come again, please?
The thread class, this thread class is having properties that would describe the thread.
Mm-hmm.
That is talking about the features of thread.
Yes.
Whereas runnable interface is having only run method.
Yes, yes, I agree.
So in our threads, so maybe my thread, there is an example, my thread is going to display numbers from 1 to 10 assume. The task that is performed by thread is displaying numbers from 1 to 10.
Okay.
Job done by the thread. Where do you write that code? Displaying number, printing numbers from 1 to 10? Generating numbers from 1 to 10? Where do you write?
Yeah.
I am asking you, where do you write that code in your program? That is, generating numbers from 1 to 10. that is the task that is done by the thread.
Okay.
Where do you write?
Right.
Suppose you are writing a thread program.
Mm-hmm.
And your thread has to generate numbers from 1 to 10.
Mm-hmm.
This is the task that is executed by the thread. Where do you write that logic of generating numbers?
The logic of generating numbers from 1 to 10?
Right, right. Where? In which?
Yeah.
Where do you write?
In a class?
In a class, of course. Particularly where?
By system.out.
Of course, system.out.print. I am not asking the instructions. I am asking you the location. Where do you write?
In a array, integer.
No. You are not able to catch my point.
Okay.
So in class, there will be methods, variables, right?
Yes.
So where do you write that logic?
The method.
Method. Particularly in run method, you will be writing the logic, right?
Yeah.
Now do you remember? Are you able to catch?
Okay.
So whatever the task that is executed by thread, the instructions that are related with that task are mentioned in run method.
Run method.
Now
okay.
Is it clear?
Right. Yes, okay. It is clear.
So when you are extending your thread class, then you are going to write that generating the numbers in run method. Got it?
Okay.
Got it.
And when you are implementing the runnable interface, of course you have only one thing that is run. You have to write that in
run method. Yes, yes.
So the thing is, threads are to perform some jobs, right?
Okay.
Their intention is to perform some job. So when do you go for extending a thread? And when do you go for implementing a thread? So the reason is, when you want to give thread specific behavior, then you will be going for extending the thread, because there are thread specific properties here. Got?
Mm. Got it.
Yes.
So that is, you will be extending the thread. Suppose you are focusing on only the task, then you can prefer runnable interface implemented. Mm-hmm. Because runnable interface has only run method, which talks about only job done by the thread.
Thread.
Got it?
Got it.
Yes.
It means when we are executing a program, the threads are called by default, means this run method for like a thread is called by default?
Yes, run method is called by default.
Okay.
We are not going to invoke that run method.
Okay.
And
can you give an example with these other specifications?
Yeah. I will execute a sample. Still, we are working on the theory.
Okay.
I'm giving you the background details about the threads. Still, we will execute a sample.
Yeah.
All right. Sure.
I'm just pointing out the differences of extending and implementing, and when do you go particularly for extending, and when do you go for particularly the implementation. Okay. Just hold on. I'm getting a call. Let me answer.
Okay.
Hello. Yes. I am back.
Okay.
We will be discussing thread life cycle stages. This part I am postponing to tomorrow because I have another session. For now, I am winding up the session. Okay.
All right.
Tomorrow we will discuss thread life cycle. Then we will be seeing thread synchronization concept.
Okay.
By example. So these two things, and we will write a simple programs using threads. So simple program. So with this, I will close the thread session, and then we will run into Java IOs.
Okay.
Then followed by JDBC, servlets, JSPs. So this would be our upcoming sessions.
All right.
Fine. I will send you this notepad for your reference, and we shall meet tomorrow same time.
All right.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, bye.